Continuing the discussion on Indian scenario on augments, brief introduction of the faculty. Dr. Bajpayee, we have already been introduced to in the morning, professor of pediatric surgery from AIIMS, Delhi. Dr. Karmakar, senior consultant in pediatric surgery from Leelavati Hospital, Mumbai. Dr. Ramesh Babu, pediatric urologist from MJ Medical College, Chennai. We'll just briefly go through some points. Many of them have been discussed by Dr. Mark Kane in the routine scenario. So just try to highlight whatever is different here or any problems we have faced in our socioeconomic situation. We go through with the indications. Dr. Karmakar, you have a lot of patients with neuropathic bladders because of your work with patient with spina bifida. So how would you select patients who would want to go on to augmentation?
I think as has been mentioned, one of the indications is a hostile bladder and patients who are incontinent. So but if you ask me, in my experience, a lot of patients eventually, we are talking of the group of spina bifida patients who are completely wet, and most of them would eventually at some point be dry enough only after an augmentation. And I, for one, wholeheartedly agree with Dr. Snodgrass's comment that preoperative urodynamics is, I believe, doesn't guide you about the need for an augmentation. So I for one, have stopped doing. I used to do a lot of machine urodynamics, but lately we have stopped doing urodynamics because we think they don't. We are not able to predict the need for an augment based on urodynamics.
At what age, Dr. Bajpayee, would you start considering augment? What is the age group you generally look at, and what is the youngest age you would want to intervene with?
Augmentation in the neurogenic bladder background or augmentation
in general, both in the subgroups,
4 or 5 years of age. And I'm looking at the data from bladder extrophy. That is my main group of patients where I augment bladders. And I use only stomach, so I would like to declare that my bias would be there, because I have used stomach since 1992, the 4 years since I became consultant. The reason I'm trying to qualify, there was a question from the audience, does augmentation lead to delay in renal failure? Well, augmentation, if there is a renal failure which has set in and you have augmented in time, you can certainly plateau it off. But as such, patients who have a renal disease, it progresses on its own space. Now, stomach I have used, I must qualify here if you permit. I use stomach, and you are at my registrar, so you know about it, because it is the segment of GIT which has the least goblet cell population as compared to colon, which has the goblet cell population with its mucus, flocculation, stasis, infection, and stone formation and whatnot. And it also secretes acids. So patients who have borderline renal dysfunction, their metabolic acidosis is taken care of. It is a thick wall, and it integrates very well with patients with bladder extrophy who, after augmentation, have voluntary voiding. So, and I had a chance of opening bladders for stone in some of my colleagues who do colon for augmentation, and I found that you could virtually see through and through. The colon becomes so thin and transparent, whereas the stomach is thick-walled. So there are many reasons because of which the first augment which I did in my career was stomach, and after that, after reading Michel's article, and after that I may have done 70 plus, but majority of these are on bladder extrophy. Coming to neurogenic bladder part, as Michel's statement saying that if you are requiring augmentation in neurogenic bladder and PUV cases, you are probably not managing them very well. I have a clinic with more than 360 PUVs, equal number of VURs, 150 plus neurogenic bladders, but the number of, in my series of augmentation, there are only 3 or 4 neurogenic bladders which have been augmented. They are the ones referred to me by pediatric nephrologists who are waiting for transplant program. So I am managing my patient very well, and therefore probably I am with Dr. Snodgrass that if you manage them well, you might actually avoid indication for augmentation. So I'm just trying to scan what I know about it, and my questions and my answers would be having a bias of stomach. So probably I will not be able, the best person to answer question in terms of that. So with this background, I would augment at 5 or 6 years of age, because most of my bladders are bladder extrophy cases.
I'll come back to again, Dr. Ramesh.
Just a quick comment about age. I mean, I think 3 to 5 years is a good time. Whenever we have had patients come to us at a later age, it's technically a great disadvantage because the pelvis is deep and getting down to the bladder neck and doing a good bladder neck repair is fairly difficult. So I think you need to operate on them at younger ages and not postpone the augmentation and the bladder neck closure for say 8 years, 10 years. But maybe we could ask Mark as to what age he operates, or Dr. Okay. Snodgrass, if he would like to comment on the age of operation.
Well, in the neuropathic bladders, you know, I've intentionally postponed it, and so those patients have been older, 8, 9, 10 years of age. I think extrophy patients are a different group, and you know, the bladder either grows or it doesn't. And most of those have declared at a younger time. The youngest I've ever augmented a patient was 1 year of age. So I mean, I don't think there's a set time. It's just that most patients, you don't have to make a decision that you
know. Okay.
Connect a little comment to this question and answer, and that is that the notion that the children with neurogenic bladders are wet doesn't mean they have incompetent bladder neck which require tightening. They may be wet because they have overflow incontinence, and therefore, when we talk about using drugs like anticholinergics and CIC from the native urethra, we are actually addressing even some high pressure system by regular emptying. And therefore, it doesn't mean, and we have looked into these data in great detail. We have given theses to some of our residents. We have put them into stratifications, but to call it short, the number of patients with patulous bladder neck are very small. The ones which lose their bladder necks after a long period of high pressure system, they are the ones which I get for augmentation from the pediatric nephrologist, are the ones who have conked off. They had high hypertonic bladders, hypertrophied bladders. They had normal intact necks which are due to their sphincter dysenergia, but they conked off over a period of time. And they are difficult to detect whether we are dealing with high pressure system which is leaking or a low pressure system which is leaking to begin with. It's a different topic altogether, but
I think we'll come back to the
discuss it.
Dr. Ramesh, do you go by the overall biochemical and metabolic status, renal parameters, before you decide what type of bladder augment you use?
Yeah, see, augmentations, as Dr. Snodgrass has mentioned, I would personally do only for two indications, like either to protect the kidneys or to control the leakage. And that has to be corroborated with the urodynamics. It's not just one thing, like urodynamics is wrong or the symptoms are not there. Both have to be there. And that's when I augment, unless it is an extrophy group. Now, coming to augments, I have three type of situations where one is a neuropathy group where there is a combination. It may be a bad bladder or a bad sphincter or bad bladder and a sphincter. And I find that the sphincter problems are only 10%, where only sphincter is a problem. And coming to the other group, the valve bladder group, those are the ones, again, we wait for the medical management, and then only if there is an upper tract deterioration and the worsening of the creatinine or the renal function, only then we go. And extrophy group, obviously, around 3 years of age, we go for augment.
Dr. Karmakar, just a brief this thing about you have patients, because North Karnataka and close to Maharashtra, a lot of stone builds. So do you try to do something differently in these patients where you anyway expect stone formation even in normal people?
No, I think, I mean, depending on, there's no geographical bias towards selecting what type of augmentation. I mean, my practice is to do cholecystoplasties, which I've been doing now for 15, 20 years. And I'm very happy with that operation. I have done a few ileocystoplasties, but again, the long-term result as far as stones are concerned, since you asked that, is, I think, in both it's more or less the same. It essentially, prevention of stones depends on good regular washouts. But so we won't select based on where the patient comes from.
Dr. Bajpai, any thoughts on which situation you'll use only a patch and where you'd convert it into a pouch? Because you get a lot of extrophies, I think you'd be probably looking more at a pouch.
I would create a complete gastric bladder and connect it to the small native bladder. And in the neuropathic group, where the CIC is very common, they are insensitive urethra. If you have to augment these, then stomach, the problem of hematuria and dysuria is totally out because they are emptied. It doesn't come into the native urethra as urothelium. There is no pain. If they are mitrophenolved, then again they don't come in contact. And they are having borderline metabolic acidosis because of renal dysfunction that is taken care of by the stomach's dialyzing mechanism. So therefore, as I used only the gastric patch, I take as large as possible, so there is no requirement of secondary augmentation. And at the same time, it helps in so many other ways. And I would strongly recommend that if I don't see hematuria dysuria the way it is talked about in the West, probably our diet is like that or whatever, and I keep a very close monitoring in terms of drugs that I am giving, or our diet is different, I don't really know. It has never been a problem with me. Mild hematuria dysuria once in a while takes place. A severe ones, I have to really think hard when it happened last. So therefore, even if somebody is worried about hematuria and dysuria with stomach, native CIC-based neurogenic bladder augment should be stomachs, because you're not bothered about that, because it's not coming into contact of urothelium. That's where the dysuria would take place. And if you are having a channel here, again, it's a boon, because you are emptying it regularly. So therefore, I take a big chunk of stomach, and I would put it like this to augment the bladder.
Dr. Ramesh, when you do an augment, do you re-implant all the ureters?
If it is an extrophic group, it's more of a pouch kind of reconstruction. So at that time, I re-implant it into the bowel segment. Whereas if it is a valve bladder group or the neuropathic group, I don't re-implant, and usually the augment itself takes care of it. The only exception is when you doubt about an obstruction. Obstructive megaureter is also there.
When you have a megaureter without a reflux?
Yeah, those cases I re-implant. But if it's a reflux alone, and then it's not a, you know, obstructive, it's draining freely once the catheter is in, I don't.
And if when you're adding on a mitrophenol, where would you re-implant it into? Implanted into?
Into
the bladder or into the augment?
The mitrophenol goes into the bladder only. And the ureters also go into the, ureters go into the bowel segment. But the ureters, I don't re-implant in the neuropathy group. Dr. Only in the extrophic group.
Dr. Karmakar, any difference, sir?
Yes, as far as minor grades of reflux, if it's grade 1, grade 2 reflux, in a case which you're going to augment, then you may not really do a re-implant, because after a good successful augment, these minor grades of reflux usually should disappear. That's what we have seen in some of our cases. As far as re-implanting the, or where to fix the mitrophenol, it's better to fix it into the bladder itself, but sometimes you are limited by the length of the appendix. If the pedicle of the appendix is small, it may not come down enough to be re-implanted in the bladder. In that situation, you can very well re-implant in the augmentation itself. Same thing applies with the ureters. If the bladder is very tiny, you can re-implant into the augmented segment. So,
Dr. Bajpayee, again, regarding spontaneous voiding, because in institute, I remember we used to sort of advocate that very commonly. So when do you decide, or do you still have a selection bias on to whom to put them on spontaneous voiding, where you do mitrophenol in all of them and then decide?
As I said, that I have a bias. The majority of my augments are on bladder extrophy. Bladder extrophy patients, if you just train them with Kegels type of exercises, they are dry for about 10-15 minutes. That is the time when you augment them, that is multiplied into 1.5 hours. So you have to put them on an exercise so they are dry for at least 10-15 minutes. And then you multiply it by more capacity. In neurogenic bladder scenario, this answer is not true, because I put them on CIC and anticholinergics. If there are high pressure systems and you are regularly emptying them, it's not a problem. I don't re-implant them. So therefore, those who have been re-implanted, and even if they have residual urine, because residual urine is acidic, it is bactericidal, and therefore they are not on antibiotics also. So reflux, even if it's the residual urine after reflux which invites infection. Here is a urine which may reflux and come back into the augmented bladder. It is mixing with acidic urine. It is bactericidal, and they don't have these problems. So therefore, as I said, that I have a very heavy bias. So I declared it initially that in stomach augmentations, I do not re-implant ureters altogether. And not anymore.
No, there are about series, spontaneous there are voiding. I am talking about spontaneous voiding.
In bladder extrophy, I said, if you achieve a period of 15 minutes of dryness.
So in all your extrophy, you would not add on the metoprolol if you have already primed?
Hardly ever.
Dr. Ramesh?
Answer is nil.
Regarding?
Regarding the same thing, spontaneous voiding versus.
Yeah, see, spontaneous voiding is not complete in these patients. So they should be trained for CIC, and if you allow them on spontaneous voiding, they're going to have huge residuals, and that is one reason where they can go for UTIs.
Dr. Karmakar, about follow-up, with respect to period and routine follow-up, anything different from standard literature?
Nothing very much different, but we have not got to the stage of doing cystoscopies and sampling or doing cytology for malignancy yet. But maybe we'll reach that stage sometime soon, but otherwise I think we broadly follow the same protocols as were mentioned. Ultrasound, cystogram.
And you use colon, Dr. Ramesh Babu?
See, I use ileal segment.
So we have three different things. So with respect to secondary augments in all these three situations, what is your incidence of requiring secondary?
I have had the opportunity to do it twice in two cases where the capacity after a colocystoplasty wasn't up to our expectations. So I went and put an ileal patch onto the colocystoplasty. But I mean, it's not, if it's required, it's a very simple thing to do. And I don't think you should shy away from doing a secondary augment. But if the primary procedure is good, I don't think you need to do it so often.
I have not done, but coming to the residual urine part, I have answered part one where it's acidic urine. When we fix the suprapubic tube, when you do augment, you have a drainage for a period of time. We fix it to the lower abdominal wall here, and that becomes the point of tethering, and that allows urine to drain into the bladder instead of sagging down retrovesically, and that's why probably stasis is also much less. So I'm just trying to answer that part of residual urine
Ramesh,
question.
Regarding re-augments?
I hardly have done any re-augments.
Dr. Bajpayee, just since you're talking about gastrocystoplasty, in Dr. McCain's talk, he reported almost 10% bowel obstruction following gastric augments compared to all other, and of course sigmoid, compared to ileum and colon. So what is your...
He mentioned the pedicle may come in the way. We put it retrocolic around the right paracolic gutter, and it goes through the ileocecal mesentery, and I have never found any problem because we fix it right up to the surface of the mesentery as it comes up, and the small bubble goes up. I've never seen, it's not like a tent which will herniate, so probably that is the reason I have not seen obstructions, and it's almost since 92, so many years have happened, 70 cases, a long-term follow-up, I haven't seen that.
Dr. Karmakar, regarding stones,
yes.
There was discussion about endoscopic versus open removal. I think, what is your incidence and what is your management?
I have seen three stones in my series of about 50 patients. One was really huge, and we thought it best to go in again and remove it with the open technique. In a couple of patients who have now reached adulthood, about 20 years, 22 years old, one was a case of extrophy who's augmented. In him, the Mitrofenov channel was wide enough for us to put an endoscope and then blast the stone, but it required a prolonged intraoperative irrigation to see that every fragment came out. I mean, I was helped with one of our adult urologists, and he took almost 2.5 hours to irrigate the augmented bladder to flush out all the fragments. I would rather like to prevent stones than having to tackle them, but in case they happen, and they will happen in some cases, then it's not too difficult. You can either do open, you can do endoscopic, the essential thing being to remove every bit of stone.
And these, whatever few cases you've had, they never had recurrence.
Well, I suspect one of them has had now after about 2 years, but it's small and she doesn't want it removed just yet. She was the one who had the big one initially. To prevent stones, one of the most important things is washouts. And there are some patients who are extremely compliant And some patients who would tend to miss a washout, and the mucus then becomes a nidus for stone. I would like to know from some of the experts here, I mean, there are people who say use specific solutions. I mean, I remember reading sometime urea solution to wash out mucus. And recently somebody said bicarb solution.
I think Dr. Ramesh Babu will just make a comment on that. He was talking about bicarb.
Yeah, my patients go on regular sodium bicarb washouts. The instructions of them are to do it once in 15 days for the first 2-3 months, because that's when the mucus is maximum. After 3 months, the mucus becomes less, when they can do once a month or once in 2 months. But whenever they come to the clinic, I ask them to show me, at least in front of me, you do it once. Put a soda bicarb and put some saline, and then make sure that the mucus comes out, and that motivates them to do more and more.
I think since we have just run out of time, one common question for all three of you: how long is your follow-up, and once they reach adulthood, how do you manage? Would you hand them over to the urologist, or do you continue to manage?
Well, currently my patients prefer to come to me for follow-up, although their questions and their issues become more and more difficult to handle. For example, I mean, if they come to your consulting room and you ask them to, you know, be examined, it's a big, because they don't want children sitting outside, and so the issues are different. But I think in our kind of situation, where transition is difficult, and you may end up going to an adult urologist who's never done augmentation. So I think in that scenario, it's best that they continue to follow up with you, and as long as you are happy with that and they are happy with that, I think it's fine.
Dr. Bajpayee?
The eldest patient I had the opportunity to do an augment on was 27 years old, and he searched all over and finally decided to get it done with me. So I think
it doesn't answer the question which probably you are seeking, because obviously after doing pediatric urology practice and after us and as the children grow, that we have to find an answer as to address adolescent care or something like that. But the another part of your question is to be answered, that is, stomachs don't have stones. And my children, who have gone 22 plus, they are pretty happy. Rarely they have some symptoms, and I ask them to just be careful with the drugs they are taking. So this part of the question I'm quite happy, but it's going to stare me sooner or later. And we don't have adolescent urology care. And after us whom? So from that angle, I think we have to address this question properly.
Coming to the adult urologist taking over, some of my patients have actually become 16, 17, 18, and a couple of them have received transplants also. So that is one time when the adult urologist calls me just to show where the pedicle is, where you don't want to damage before they put the ureter in. Apart from that, once they cross that, they are okay to take over the patient, because if they are transplanted, they are on the regular follow-up. Some of them are being followed up by urologists, but still, like, the cesarean section hasn't happened.
Thank you. I think we have run out of time, so we will wind up with the session. Thank you very much.